So I will try to analyze to which degree we can believe Band theory, where does it make good statements, reliable statements about Fermi surfaces. And to be specific, I will mainly consider F-electron systems because they are the most strongly correlated systems. So the overview is I will start with a short introduction. Then I will comment on density functional theory, which is widely used to calculate electronic properties in solids. I will discuss what the qualitative results are for F-electron systems, and I will comment on the failure of this method by looking at specific models where one really can pin down where the method fails. And then I will briefly comment what are the standard generalizations, how one tries to remedy some of these shortcomings, and then I will advertise, comment on my renormalized band method and show how it works in heavy fermion systems. I will give you some results on the work in progress, and I will close with a summary and an outlook. Now, for the beginning, of course, we are treating interacting electrons in a lattice. We are treating systems with many degrees of freedom. And there are two competing tendencies. First, there's a tendency towards delocalization. The system can lower its energy, its kinetic energy, by forming coherent Bloch states, and the results are then we find energy bands. On the other hand, we have a tendency towards localization, which is due to the Coulomb repulsion the electrons feel when they are at the same lattice site. And it's the competition between these tendencies which determine the properties of a solid. Now, of course, this general problem is not solved yet, and there are solutions in limiting cases. For example, if we can neglect interaction, that's the well-known theory of free electrons, which was formulated by Sommerfeld and Bethe. They showed that if you account for the wave character of the electrons and for the fact that they are spin 1/2 fermions, you can predict, you can reproduce the behavior at low temperatures where you have a linear specific heat and a constant magnetic susceptibility. The ground state is built by filling up single electron states according to the Pauli principle. And in a translational invariant system or in an isotropic system, there is a surface in K-space which separates the occupied states from the empty states, and the excitations are very simple particle-hole excitations where you promote an electron from an occupied state inside the sphere to an unoccupied state outside the sphere. And it's the character of this kind of excitations which is reflected in this linear specific heat coefficient. And since you occupy the states according to the Pauli principle, of course, the whole ground state is a singlet, which means the specific the susceptibility is constant. So this constant is the basis of electron theory of metals since these days. Band theory now uses the same paradigm. And in band theory, you simply replace the free electron energies, this quadratic dispersion, and the wave functions, the plane waves, by solutions of the Schrödinger equation, which these solutions are calculated in the presence of a periodic lattice. What you find is there are allowed regions in energy, the energy bands, which are separated by energy gaps. And the success of this ansatz is that you can explain in a consistent way that you have metals and insulators, that the Bloch functions are periodically modulated plane waves. The ground state of such a system is built in close analogy to the free electrons, and you also have a surface which is anisotropic in this case, which may have several sheets. The surface separates the occupied states from the empty states, so the excitations have the same character, so you still have this behavior, a linear specific heat and a constant susceptibility. Now, this concept of having free particles that seems plausible for the conduction electrons, for the electrons of the outer shells. The question is, what's happening to electrons in partially inner filled in the inner partially filled inner shells, like the D shell or the F shell? We know that the electron states in these partially filled inner shells preserve some of the atomic character, and there's a very famous historic controversy how to describe these in a simplified way. Of course, here Slater suggested to describe the D electrons as delocalized block states, and this ansatz could reproduce the specific heat at low temperatures, and it predicted the existence of Fermi surfaces. On the other hand, if you try to describe the behavior at higher temperatures, and in particular the magnetism, then the localized picture is more appropriate. This was emphasized by von Fleck. What we learn from this controversy is the fact that we do not have a single unique picture to describe the behavior over a broader temperature or energy range, that simply reflect that we have to deal with that we are dealing with correlated electrons, and it's the correlations which somehow suggest this kind of dual character, that sometimes the localized picture is more appropriate, and in other situations it's the itinerant picture. Now, for the F electron systems, we have an analogous situation. The only difference is that the energy or temperature scales are different. Here, the energy scales are much lower, where we can have this kind of crossover than in the D electron systems. The experimental findings are, at high temperatures, we should think of localized F states. We see crystalline field effects. At low temperatures, on the other hand, the specific heat is linear with a large linear coefficient. So this low temperature behavior would suggest that we can also devise a band picture for the 4F electrons, but this picture was initially highly controversial. Now, so we are dealing with strongly correlated electrons, and to reconcile these two regimes, we have to go beyond single particle picture, beyond the independent particle picture. And so we should not think in states, in block states and so on, but rather consider the spectral function. That means the probability of adding or removing an electron. And here I show this cartoon from this Physics Today article of Gabi Kotliar and Dieter Vollhardt, where they show the evolution of the spectral function as a function of the Coulomb repulsion. In the itinerant case, where we have free electrons, we usually have a peak of coherent states. We have coherent states in the vicinity of the Fermi surface, of the Fermi level. But as we crank on the Coulomb repulsion, which is measured now in units of the bandwidth, say the kinetic energy, that's the ratio of the interaction to the kinetic energy, then we see that the satellites appear, which become separated, and this former band part develops into a narrow many-particle resonance, and if this Coulomb repulsion is further increased, then these former satellites really separate, the weight of this low energy feature disappears, and we end up with an insulator. Now, in the context of F electron systems, heavy fermion systems, we are considering this kind of situation, that we have a narrow peak of coherent states, and on the other hand, in the other scenario, we have this kind of localized behavior. In this case, we call this that we say that the F electrons are itinerant, keeping in mind that we should be more specific and look at the spectral function. And in the situation where we don't have any spectral weight at the Fermi level, we would say the F electrons are localized, as evidenced by these Hubbard sidebands. Now the question is, if we go back to band theory, of course this situation here, band theory is useless. The question is, can we devise a band theory which can in some sense describe the dispersion of these coherent low energy excitations? Because here the coherence in the lattice is important, and we simply have to account for the renormalizations, the dynamic renormalizations, but of course the lattice periodicity is still present. In the heavy fermion systems, of course, we are dealing with not F electrons, but with the quasi-particle excitations. And if we go back to the Landau Fermi liquid picture, where we have a one-to-one correspondence between the excitations of the interacting system and the free fermions, then we see that what we should describe are the dispersions of these quasi-particles, of these strongly renormalized quasi-particles. Of course, we see that the overall behavior is implied by adopting the Landau theory. The problem is, how can we calculate these strongly renormalized quasi-particles? Now, the standard approach in band theory to have a first principles description is to use density functional theory. This density functional theory allows for ab initio calculations of the properties of solids, and the ansatz is that interaction effects are accounted for via static effective potentials. But that the electrons are independent and their dispersions are determined by effective potentials, which are given by the lattice potential, by the potential set up by the lattice ions and the electron density. This approach is very successful in predicting material properties. The central quantity here in this ansatz is the electron density in the ground state. The way it works is it's based on the Kohn-Sham equations, where one constructs the electron density, the central quantity, from effective single particle orbitals, which obey some kind of Schrödinger-type equation. But one has to keep in mind, strictly speaking, that the energies which appear here like band energies and these orbitals, these single particle orbitals, they are auxiliary quantities which are designed to parameterize the ground state density, which is the central quantity. The assumption is now that these quantities, these auxiliary quantities, can be interpreted as excitation energies and wave functions. And the empirical result is that this assumption works well for weakly correlated electron systems. So now the question is, can we use this ansatz also in the strongly correlated systems? Now, if we look at the most strongly correlated systems, the F electron systems, we have to say there are successes in this ansatz. It's the conduction bands in these materials, they are typically well described by density functional theory, and this is confirmed by ARPES measurements. Typically, the total magnetic moment is well described, and in many materials, also the Fermi surfaces, which are the central part of this workshop, they are also reasonably well described. The question is, is this a happy coincidence? Is this an artifact? How can we understand that the Fermi surfaces are well described by density functional theory? there are also the well-known failures. This density functional theory is principally unable to reproduce a paramagnetic state with F occupation close to unity and simultaneously a high density of states. Then if we look at the spectral function, the low energy peak in the density of state usually comes out too wide. This means the effective masses of the quasiparticles are underestimated. And on the other hand, the overall bandwidth is too small because this theory does not predict or does not reproduce the multiplets. Now, if we try to understand why the Fermi surfaces are well described, we have to go back and look what we are calculating. And an important point is, how do we solve the band structure problem? Now, a convenient way is to imagine the solution of the band structure problem in close to see this in close analogy to scattering theory. In a multiple scattering picture, we get the block states by considering the multiple scattering of electrons of the periodic atomic potentials. So what we find then is we have a separation into a geometric problem, which is due to the propagation between the sites, and also the scattering properties of the individual scatterers, which are typically parameterized by phase shifts. Then putting everything together, for example, in the linear Muffin-Tin orbital formalism, we find a condition which relates energies to k vectors by solving this kind of secular equation, which has two ingredients. One ingredient are the potential functions, which are energy dependent and which describe the behavior of the individual sites. And then there are the structure constants, which account for the lattice geometry. And they are k-dependent. Now, the individual sites here, that's what is material dependent, and the structure constant, that's just pure geometry. Now, the question is, why does density functional theory often give good Fermi surfaces in heavy fermion systems? And we consider, for example, uranium-based heavy fermion systems. In uranium systems, we know we have the 5F states. The spin orbit interaction is large. The crystal field splitting is not terribly important. So we have six states out of the J equal 5 half multiplet, which are more or less equivalent. Going back to the band structure problem, we see that the energy, that the surfaces of constant energy in K space are parameterized by the scattering properties of the individual sites, that means by the phase shifts, which are energy dependent. Now we know that we have two types of phase shifts. One set parameterizes the scattering properties for the conduction electrons, and then there are the F electrons. We do not know whether they are well described by density functional theory. On the other hand, so these phase shifts, they parameterize the constant energy surfaces. So the Fermi surface is nothing but a special constant energy surface. The Fermi surface is therefore given by a set of phase shifts of for the conduction electrons and also for the F channels. On the other hand, it's not only the surface, but if we know have the surface, then also the volume is given by this set of phase shifts. The volume of the Fermi surface, however, is fixed by particle number. And this is some kind of generalized Friedel sum rule here. So the relation between the volume of the Fermi surface and the particle numbers, that fixes one degree of freedom. And so if we can assume, if we know that the phase shifts and all the properties of conduction electrons are well described by density functional theory, and if all the F channels are equivalent, so we have only a single degree of freedom for the F electrons, then the F-electron phase shift is simply fixed by particle number. And if the conduction electron properties are properly described. So that means if we are in a situation where all the uranium sites, for example, are equivalent, then the Fermi surface does not depend on the detailed description of the 5F electrons. This means simply because we can describe the conduction states, then we also find a good description of the Fermi surfaces. So the Fermi surfaces do not necessarily reflect the correlation properties in the system. And for the so this is the argumentation for the uranium-based heavy fermion systems. A similar kind of argumentation can be constructed for the cerium systems. This means, of course, we can do density functional theory. We find Fermi surfaces which, under certain conditions, correspond to the experiment, but that doesn't tell you anything about the F-electron character. So now let's analyze the successes of the density functional theory. Now let's come to the failure of it. Why does it fail in certain situations? And this can be seen from a single molecular model where we replace the conduction band by a single ligand and we keep the F-electron site, which has the strong correlations. There's some hybridization transferring an electron from this correlated F site to the conduction state. If we consider a two-electron state, then, of course, in the absence of hybridization, the ground state is four-fold degenerate. And if we switch on a weak hybridization, this degeneracy is removed, and we get a lowering of the singlet state, which is a dynamical energy scale, and we have a ground state which has this kind of structure. The question is, what are the predictions of density functional theory in this situation? So here we can solve the model exactly, and since we have the exact ground state energy, we have the exact ground state density, we can also derive the exact density functional and see what the results are for density functional theory in this situation. Okay, so we take this molecular model. It's a two-side problem because we have this correlated side and this uncorrelated side. The density distribution, which is the fundamental quantity in density functional theory, that can be characterized by the F occupation, and the other one is just the complementary number. The F-electron energy, which determines the F-electron count, is taken as a potential. And the hybridization, which transfers electrons from one side to the other, that plays the role of the kinetic energy in typical density functional theory. Now, we can construct the exact density functional for this model. We use the exact ground state energy. We subtract the potential contribution. We express the F-electron energy, which is something like the potential, in terms of the density distribution. And we perform this kind of Legendre transformation to the energy to the density representation. And what we get here is an expression, the ground state energy expressed in terms of the density. What is remarkable here in this exact density functional is that we have a special particle hole symmetry, which is a particle hole symmetry somehow in the lower Hubbard band. It's not the conventional particle hole symmetry. Now, of course, we now want to do local density approximation and the Kohn-Sham formalism. So we have to construct the non-interacting reference system. So we need this non-interacting reference system, which is characterized by the same density, to construct the kinetic energy. And if we have the kinetic energy, we can extract the correlation exchange correlation potential. Now, in the non-interacting reference system, the energy values are determined from the eigenvalues of a simple 2x2 problem. The potential here, this parameter eta, is chosen so as to reproduce the density distribution because it's the reference system. And then we can extract the kinetic energy from this simple model. And what we find here is an expression which is rather similar to the exact density functional, but it has particle hole, the conventional particle hole symmetry. So now, having the kinetic energy and the exact density functional, we can construct the exchange correlation potential. And that can be done by subtracting the Hartree contribution. And what we find here is the Hartree is that the exchange correlation potential is proportional to the Coulomb repulsion. In the limit of large Coulomb repulsion, the exchange correlation potential mainly compensates the large Hartree term, so it does not describe the genuine many-body effects. If we now put everything together into the Kohn-Sham equations, we can solve them, and what we find here are the following properties. First of all, the exchange correlation potential compensates the Hartree term, so it does not really account for this very complicated many-body effects. The F electron position is renormalized, it lies above the ligand, and the eigenvalues here, the excitation energies, they scale with a bare hybridization. Hybridization here is not renormalized. There's no dynamic renormalization here. And this is exactly what we find. If we now replace the ligand by the conduction band, then we see the characteristic results in density functional theory is that we have an F band which is shifted to the Fermi energy. The F count is usually correct. So we usually have a reasonable Fermi level, but the bandwidth is too broad. Okay, so that's density functional theory, the failure in the condor type systems. Now, in the uranium systems, there are even more subtle failures. Here, the heavy quasi-particles arise basically from the intra-atomic correlations. That means we have an orbital-dependent renormalization, because if we transfer an electron from, say, from a threefold occupied site to a doubly occupied site, we have to account for the intra-atomic structure. And what this means is this can be summarized in this picture. You all know this riddle of the man who should transfer a cabbage, a goat, and a wolf across a river. Now, these three entities, they are strongly correlated, they are strongly interacting. And the strong correlations imply that he cannot pick the entities at random to transfer them across the river, but he must always keep in mind what is left behind. And that's also in these systems. If you have now the interaction between these three different orbitals, that's given by the Hund's-Rule correlations. If you have Hund's-Rule correlated sites, you should not take out an orbital at random and transfer it to the neighboring site. There are some combinations which are favorable, others are not, and this gives a renormalization, orbital-dependent renormalization of the bandwidth. And if one does it in such a model calculation, a two-side model, we see here a phase diagram where you have the transfer integrals for the exact solution, and then this is something which is called LDA plus U. That means a common approximation in band theory that you use a local density approximation and you put in by hand this effect of the Coulomb repulsion. Certain features are reproduced by this approximation, but we see here that this approximate treatment, which is very common in band theory of F electron systems, that reproduces phases where we have large, where we have either very large magnetic moments or where we have small magnetic moments. But these complicated, subtle, intermediate size moments are not reproduced. And another thing is here there is a line of where all these transfer integrals are identical, there's a line of very high degeneracy. So this degeneracy, this six-fold degeneracy, does not appear in this approximate treatment, which explicitly breaks the translational the rotational invariance. And as this rotational invariance is broken, the level density, since the degeneracy is removed, also the level density is reduced by a factor of the order of 6, which is probably the missing enhancement observed experimentally in the specific heat. So this is the other difficulty we encounter in F electron systems. Now, of course, there are lots of attempts to go beyond density functional theory. For example, for weakly correlated metals, people construct self-energies using GW, RPA, and God knows what approximations. The difficulties, for example, in Kondor systems is that these schemes do not work well for Anderson impurity systems in the strong coupling regime, their divergences. So using such a scheme should be met with skepticism in the context of F-electron systems. So what we are using is the renormalized band method, and that means we use the Landau ansatz that the correlated the aspect that we have correlated electrons can be included by some phenomenological parameter which is directly related by to experiment. And the way to parameterize here is that we introduce a resonant phase shift only for the F channel, and this phase shift is characterized by a width of the resonance and a resonance position. We know that there is a resonance close to the Fermi level since we have partially filled F shells, then of course such a structure must be close to the Fermi level. Now we impose the condition that there should be no major redistribution of the charges as compared, for example, to density functional theory, because density functional theory is devised to produce a good charge distribution in the system. So if we impose this condition, then a single parameter is left that can be adjusted to the specific heat. In an external magnetic field, of course, these parameters will be field dependent, and we will use them, their field dependence, later. And so this leads to the following calculational scheme. The starting point is a self-consistent local density band structure calculation, so it's a fully ab initio calculation generating atomic potential and lattice structures, and these self-consistent potentials, they determine the conduction electrons from which we know that they are well described by density functional theory. The heavy masses, they are accounted for in this phenomenological way, and the result are the renormalized bands. There are some successes. The Fermi surfaces, the anisotropies, and the effective masses are well described. The ansatz also describes the instabilities of the Fermi liquid. The de-renormalization in a magnetic field that can be accounted for, and in particular the Lifshitz transitions. What we would want, of course, is a more microscopic determination of the effective mass and the temperature-dependent F-spectral function. Now, just flash through through the successes. It was possible to predict the strongly renormalized Fermi surface, so the paper is from 1990, and the existence of this Fermi surface and was confirmed experimentally 2 years later. And then another prediction was the formation of a spin density wave in cerium copper to silicon II. The calculation predicted a nesting vector, which was later confirmed by inelastic neutron scattering. Another success is the coexistence of localized and delocalized F electrons in uranium-based materials, and here we could predict the effective masses observed in band theory without an adjustable parameter. Now, let me now come to ytterbium, rhodium to silicon II. Here we see the prediction is the Fermi surface looks like that if we look on it just from the z direction, and so that's what it looks like, what we extract from the calculation, and that's what is observed in the experiment. So it's confirmed that in ytterbium, rhodium to silicon 2, in vanishing magnetic field, in the paramagnetic state, we should have a Fermi surface which is where the F electrons should have band character and contribute to the Fermi surface. So that's confirmed. Now the question is, what happens in a magnetic field? In a magnetic field where we break the Condor correlations, of course we expect that the masses become lighter, and that's also seen here if we look at the effective bandwidth. The effective here we plot the renormalized bandwidth of a Condor system for a Condor impurity as a function of the Zeeman splitting, the bare Zeeman splitting divided by the characteristic temperature. So we see in the absence of a magnetic field, the bandwidth is very, very low, corresponding to high effective masses. And as the magnetic field is increased, of course, there's a crossover to the free particle bandwidth. That's what one really expects, that the quasi-particles are de-renormalized in the magnetic field. More interesting is the effective Zeeman splitting. We know in the absence of a field, we have this value, this enhanced value of 2 corresponding to Wilson's ratio. And if the magnetic field is increased, this effective Zeeman splitting goes to a maximum and then also goes down to unity. So there's a strong enhancement over the bare Zeeman splitting in these materials, and that's even field dependent. I should emphasize that this behavior, this maximum here, that's in the metal, it would be in rather high magnetic field, so it's not observed. It is observed in a Condor effect in a quantum dot. In a quantum dot, this regime is accessible, and we could show that this is this leads to very interesting effects. Okay, so how can we understand this maximum? Of course, if we look, this here is the result from the numerical renormalization group, and if we look at this enhanced Zeeman splitting, of course we see here the mean field result, and then it increases here we have the fully polarized case, and if we now if we divide it by the magnetic field, of course this increases, but then as we lower the magnetic field, then at some point the transversal spin fluctuations come into play, and if we do the simplest thing, namely RPA, this shows how it turns over, and then it eventually it saturates in the strong coupling regime at the value of 2. This strong enhancement of the Zeeman splitting, this leads to dramatic effects in the Fermi surface of heavy fermion materials, especially here in ytterbium, rhodium to silicon 2. Because the overall bandwidth is very narrow, we really can induce Lifshitz transitions by a magnetic field, and this is observed here, for example, in the specific heat coefficient as a function of magnetic field. And we see here there are several regimes where the chain, where the shape of the Fermi surfaces change dramatically. And also these changes, these Lifshitz transitions also are reflected in transport properties. Here on the left-hand side, you see these different Fermi surfaces in different regimes. And here we have the measurements from the Dresden group. You see structures at well-defined values of the field in basically all the transport properties. And also you see the same singularities or structures in the measurements of the Grenoble group. So from this we see that in a magnetic field we have both effects, the quasi-particle de-renormalization and this strongly enhanced Sommerfeld-Wilson ratio. And of course, if we have to account for the crystal field states, and this leads to structures at characteristic fields of in the magnetic field, and they indicate Lifshitz transitions. Now the work in progress is now, we know that in vanishing magnetic field, the Fermi surface of this material corresponds to itinerant electrons. The question is, of course, this corresponds really to delocalized F electrons, because say a reference compound which does not have any F electrons has a completely different Fermi surface. Topologically, they are not so much different, but the difference is here there's an open neck which does not appear in this lutetium compound. So if the material is now, if the temperature is raised, the question is, how do the F electrons become incoherent? At which temperature? What's the relevant temperature scale? And we can monitor this by looking at this open neck, because the closing of this neck would indicate the transition from having from F electrons contributing to the Fermi surface to electrons which are incoherent. Okay, it's described in terms of the spectral function, and the experimental results, the amazing experimental result is that these coherent features, the coherence features are persistent to rather high temperatures. So we have in this material not a breakdown at the Kondo energy, but at least 3 times to 4 times the Kondo energy. We see this open neck here up to 120 degrees at roughly. And this means it's not a sudden breakdown of the large Fermi surface, but it's this very slow exponential crossover we know from the impurity results. The question is now, what happens here at the quasi-particles? That's a different story. So let us go now to the conclusions we can draw from the photoemission result at elevated temperatures. Here I plot the phase diagram of this material. This material is famous because it has it's thought to have a magnetic field-induced quantum critical point here. The low temperature phase has some interferomagnetic correlations, and which are suppressed by magnetic field, and at 70 millitesla, a Fermi liquid state is forming, and as I showed you, the Fermi surface persists to higher fields. There is an anomaly line, a line in the temperature versus magnetic field phase diagram, where many transport properties, many properties have anomalies. And this anomaly line was usually thought to be associated with the Kondo breakdown, with the transition from the large Fermi surface to the small Fermi surface. But if we now mark the regimes where we know that we have the large Fermi surface, here at high temperatures, above 1 Kelvin, and here at high magnetic fields, I think it's not so, it's at least questionable whether we start from a large Fermi surface, somehow cross over to a small one and have a Kondo breakdown somewhere. That's somehow this anomalies should arise from a different mechanism, I think, at least in this part of the phase diagram. I don't make any statements about the behavior here in the quantum critical regime. There's an ansatz here that the quasi particles, that these quantum critical properties could arise from critical quasi particles. That's a theory by Abrahams, Schmalian, and Wölfle, and they show that they can describe quantum critical properties in cerium copper gold in cerium copper gold system, also with this more conventional theory, which does not assume any Kondo breakdown. Okay, so that's the heretic view graph, and now let me go back. What we have here in this thing, we use the renormalized band theory, which has a phenomenological parameter in it. And often we get the recommendation that one should use density dynamical mean field theory. Now let's compare these two schemes. There's a common feature that both schemes use the conduction bands from first principle band structure calculations. And on the other hand, what is often overlooked, that in our case, it's obvious that we introduce a parameter for a correlated electrons, but also the dynamical mean field theory parameterizes the interaction effects. The main difference is what quantities are parameterized. So we parameterize this narrow feature here. The dynamical mean field theory, they parameterize instead these Hubbard sidebands by introducing Hubbard U's and also all kinds of exchange integrals. But the bottom line is they are also parameterizing the interaction effects. What they are doing is they parameterize this part of the spectrum and then work and calculate the narrow resonance. So, of course, it would be desirable to do this from first principles, but so far we don't know how to do this. And so with this, I would like to summarize. If you want to read more details about this, you can find it in a review article which I wrote, and it should appear in reports on progress in physics quite soon. I was a little late in finishing my manuscript, so it's not yet published. And outlook is we try to incorporate microscopic calculations of the spectral functions also via the renormalized perturbation theory. And with this, I would like to conclude. I thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions.